अरे और
This is red. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to An Academy, where you can crack all NEET PG exams with us, with our top educators, quality content, and have a great learning experience. So, guys, let's crack An Academy together. A little about me. I'm Dr. Sasha Menon Remedies. I have done my MD in anesthesia from Fathermole Medical College, Mangalore. I have two publications and one paper presentation in the field of anesthesia, and I've been working and teaching in Bangalore for the past 2.5 years. So today's topic is central venous catheter access. I'll be taking this class in two parts. It will be back to back, but I will log out and then take the class again. Okay, just a sec, guys. Okay. So that's how we are going to go about this class. So like I said, central venous access and catheters. So this is an ICU topic, and we'll go through it in two parts with a 5-minute gap between the classes. So in two parts, I will take this class. So this class will be from about 6:40 right now to 7:40, and then again at 7:50 I will start a class, right? So a little about An Academy. It's one of India's largest online learning platform, and where you can get plus subscription and access unlimited live and recorded courses from India's best educators. So what will you get out of An Academy? So basically, out of An Academy, we have daily life classes. So these daily life classes, so when you go, basically when you go to a coaching institute, you waste a lot of energy, a lot of time traveling. Then by the time you reach there, you have to get your educator, you have to get a proper seat. Okay, once you get the proper seat, then again you have to get your educator's attention. And it all becomes very tiresome and difficult. But over here at An Academy, these are all online classes. So during class, you can ask your doubts. We will clear your doubts. And to the best of our ability, we will try to clear your doubts then and there. These are all structured courses, so based on whatever is needed for your classes from NEET PG point of view, these courses have been prepared, and that is how we will go about these courses. Then live tests and quizzes. So we prepare regular. We have regular tests which mock tests we conduct, and this will give a detailed analysis on your you can assess your performance. Then one subscription, of course, this is one subscription, and it can get you access to all our live and recorded courses, and you can watch from the comfort of any of your devices. Now, these are our top educators. Dr. Nikita Nanmani, she's a NEET PG mentor for radiology as well as mnemonics and concept focusing on must know topics. Dr. Mohammad Azam, Dr. Divish Mishra, Dr. Preeti Sharma. So these are all the top educators on this platform. Now, these are some of the courses offered. As you can see, there are various subjects that you all have to cover. Now, it has to be done. These are not easy subjects. I do agree with you all. These are not easy subjects, but it has to be done, and we are here to help you. Now, certain subjects like anesthesia, psychiatry, radiology, pharmacology, etc. These subjects you all have to, dermatology, we didn't have to go through them in detail during our post-graduation, right? We didn't have much in detail to do with them. But over here, we have to get into detail with these courses. and you will not be able to give answers without going through, you know, whatever is there here in these courses. So it has to be, in the sense, it you cannot answer NEET PG without studying them. You don't have to go that much in detail, because like in MBBS, they will not ask you everything in this course, right? Everything in the sense, they will not ask you from everywhere. They will ask you only certain aspects of it, and it will be superficial, but not as superficial as MBBS. So these are 11 marks. So each of these smaller subjects, these subjects which are not in detail, they are not small subjects, they're very huge, but they are allotted around 11 marks. Now these 11 marks are very easy to score, because if you have gone through the courses and the course structure and have studied these subjects, you know, for NEET PG, you can clear these subjects. Whereas your anatomy, physiology and all that is 44 marks. They can ask you anything from anywhere. So, quite frankly, I feel these are easier to score in. These are some of the ongoing courses on our platform. Course on neurophysiology, GI surgery, cardiovascular thoracic surgery, capsule on the larynx, respiratory system, course on pathology. So now coming to the subscription part of it, as you can see, there are 5 types of subscription on your screen. So as you can see, there are 5 types of subscription on your screen. And if you're planning, those of you who are giving NEET PG this year, 6 months subscription is more than enough. For the rest of you, this 12 and 24 months is what I would suggest. So 12 months is a very good subscription, what I feel. Nobody will ask you how long you all took to clear NEET PG. Nobody will get into such details about NEET PG. So nobody is going to ask you such questions as to why did you take so long, or how long did you take extra, etc. Nobody will ask you such questions. This 12 and 24 months are good deals, and they're more economical, because after 6 months, once this expires, you have to pay again. So again, that's like, it is kind of a waste of money, right? So again, so that's where you can, this 12 months, 24 months is a good buffer period. Then of course we have, so subjects, now this y'all will be choosing something which y'all will be working on for the rest of your life. So you'll need to enjoy what y'all are doing, right? This 12 and 24 months gives y'all that time. Y'all are going through the subject, studying each subject. It gives y'all time to know what you like and don't like. So these are the benefits. Now use my code Sasha to avail a 10% discount. As you can see here, these are the amount, and this is your 10% discount. So again, for the 24 month subscription, the discount applies on all the subscription, not just the 12 and the 24. Use a 10%, use my code, and you can avail a 10% discount, and any of the subscriptions, whichever y'all want, that is up to y'all. The discount applies on all the subscription, not just the 12. Now coming to the central venous catheter. So anyone who inserts a central venous catheter, which is an indwelling intravenous device that is inserted into a vein of central vasculature. So anyone who is central vasculature, so anyone who inserts a vascular catheter must follow standard infection control practice. So standard infection control practice, hand washing with antimicrobial soap or gel recommended, for then hand washing, the hand should be decontaminated, then the gloves have to be sterile, so hand wash, sterile gloves, sterile drapes, sterile gowns, okay, so for all these, including peripherally inserted central vascular access, these infection control practices have to be performed. So the uses of a central venous catheter are difficult peripheral vascular access, like patients with burns, previous vein injuries such as IV drug users and all that. Volume loading, the time consuming to insert and associated with high complication rates. So basically, because they are larger bores, so volume loading. And flow rate is determined by caliber and length of the catheter. That is, it is Poiseuille's law. So Hagen-Poiseuille law is basically the influence of the catheter size on flow, right? So that is the Poiseuille law. So it basically indicates the influence of catheter size on the flow. So this Hagen-Poiseuille law is basically the flow rate. The steady flow in a catheter is directly related to, it is directly related to the pressure gradient along the catheter, and the fourth power of the radius of the catheter, and is inversely related to the length of the catheter. So it is inversely related to the length of the catheter and the viscosity of the fluid. So mu is the viscosity of fluid. L is the length of the catheter. Right? The principal determinant of flow in the equation is the radius of the catheter. So the principal determinant is the radius of the catheter. The relationship between catheter diameter and flow rate is the main thing. Okay? So as the diameter changes, there is a equivalent change in flow. So greater the diameter, more change in flow. So basically, when you're using an 18 gauge cannula as compared to a 16 gauge cannula as compared to an 18 gauge cannula, so the 16 gauge cannula has more radius, the catheter has more radius, so the flow rate will be more. Now with central venous catheters, they are made up of 218 and 116, so the flow rate depends upon the radius. But central venous catheters are longer, so that's where they get hot. Okay, so a given change in diameter results in a proportional change in flow, reflecting the dependence of flow on a power function of the catheter radius. Okay. With the catheter length when rapid catheter diameters take precedence over catheter lengths when rapid infusions are needed. So when it comes to rapid infusions, the catheter diameter is better than the catheter length. So the performance of different size catheters for volume resuscitation is needed. So shorter and greater caliber catheters deliver greater volumes over equivalent amount of time. This is based on your Hagen-Poiseuille law. That is the flow rate. Q is the flow rate directly proportional to the pressure gradient, and the fourth power of the radius inversely proportional to the viscosity of the fluid and length of the catheter. So provision of caustic medications or solutions, that is vasoactive medications, vasopressors or ionotropes, irritant substances like chemotherapeutic agents, cytotoxic drugs or high concentration solutions, and total parenteral nutrition. These are all given through a central line. So any vasopressors are preferably given through a central line. Irritant substance like cytotoxic drugs or chemotherapeutic agents. So a peripheral line, if they irritate a small gauge vein, more chance of thrombophlebitis. So irritant substances are generally given through a larger gauge of larger vein gauge, and also for total parenteral nutrition. Now central venous pressure monitoring, central lines are also used for central venous pressure monitoring. So the central venous pressure monitoring is the pressure in the central veins close to the right atrium. So the central venous pressure monitoring is the pressure measured in the central veins close to the right atrium. It indicates mean right atrial pressure and it's frequently used as an estimate of right ventricular preload. Okay. So the central venous pressure is the pressure in the central vein close to the right atrium. It indicates right atrial pressure and used as an estimate of right ventricular preload. So this is being used as a guide for fluid management through some research suggest otherwise, but basically it is used as a guide for fluid management. Also for repeated blood sampling, introduction of pacemakers or pulmonary artery catheters for hemodialysis and hemofiltration, that is for acute and chronic hemodialysis. So that is a hemodialysis catheter, which is also a central catheter, is used. And for introduction of pacemakers and pulmonary artery catheters. Now, contraindications. Absolute contraindication is overlying skin or soft tissue infection, thrombophlebitis. So any overlying skin or soft tissue infection and thrombophlebitis are absolute contraindications. Relative contraindications are any distorted anatomy, like from trauma, deformity, burns, or infection, any infection at the site of access like cellulitis, uncooperative patients, proximal vascular injury, bleeding disorders, anticoagulation, thrombolytic therapy. So bleeding, anticoagulation and all, unless it's an emergency, it's preferable not to put. So 3% complication rate as long as there are no arterial punctures. Basically, there shouldn't be any arterial punctures, because sometimes in an emergency situation, even if the patient is on anticoagulants, we have to gain a central venous line access. So in such situations, it is preferable that the central venous line be put by someone who is experienced, right? So absolute contraindication for subclavian access, preferable not to put in the subclavian artery. Ultrasound guidance is recommended when putting with a bleeding disorder or anticoagulation therapy. Now coming to the types of central venous catheters. The various vascular catheters are made up of, they are basically made up of polymers impregnated with barium or tungsten salts to enhance radio opacity. So they are basically made up of polymers impregnated with barium or tungsten salts to enhance radio opacity. Okay, so they are polymers which are impregnated with barium or tungsten salts to enhance radio opacity. They are designed for short-term cannulation and are usually made of, catheters for short-term use are made of polyurethane. Which is a synthetic polymer which is known for its strength, durability and moisture resistance. Catheters which are designed for long use like weeks to months are made of silicone polymer that is more flexible and less thrombogenic than polyurethane. So long term use catheters are made of silicone because they have less chance of thrombophlebitis, more for long term use. They are more flexible. And because of the flexibility, silicone catheters must be inserted over a semi-rigid guide wire through a surgically created subcutaneous tunnel. So because of their flexibility, silicone catheters must be inserted over a guide wire. Now, the size of vascular catheters is measured in terms of the outside diameter of the catheter. So, the size depends on the outside diameter of the catheter. The size depends on the outside diameter of the catheter. Two units of measurement are usually used for the catheter sizes: a metric base French size and a wire gauge gauge size. So basically, French metric based French size or a wire based gauge size. Right? So French or gauge, but basically the French is a series of whole numbers that increases from 0 in 0.33 millimeters. So as a French, as for example, a French, a size 5 French catheter will have an outer diameter of 5 into 0.33. That will be around 1.655 millimeters. So a 5 French catheter will have a size of 5 into 0.33. Okay, this is the conversion, which will be equivalent to 1.65 millimeter. Okay, the gauge size was introduced for solid wires and is an expression of how many wires can be placed side by side in a given space. That is generally not used. The gauge size varies inversely with the diameter of the catheter. There is no simple relationship between gauge size and units of measurement. It is basically not used. Basically, gauge size was measured by placing wires side by side in a given space. The determinant of flow rate is by your Hegel-Poiseuille catheter. So non-tunnel catheters, tunnel catheters, peripherally inserted central catheters, implantable ports. So single and multi-lumen catheters are available in all catheter types, and each lumen must be treated as a separate catheter. So this is a single lumen tube. This is a triple lumen. This is triple lumen, and this is your triple lumen in cross section. So proximal lumen, medial lumen, and distal lumen, which is bigger. So peripheral venous catheters. They are designed for cannulation of peripheral veins and are typically short. So a peripheral venous catheter. These are all the central catheter types that we just discussed. Now, peripheral venous catheter is designed for cannulation of peripheral veins, and it is typically short, usually around 5 cm in length or 2 inches, and about 18 to 22 gauge in diameter. These catheters are usually inserted using catheter over a needle device like the one. Okay, so basically these are introduced using a stilet. So the catheter is placed over the stilet, which is the needle. The catheter fits snugly over the stilet and has a tapered end to minimize damage to the catheter tip and soft tissues during insertion. So the catheter has a tapered end. The stilet also has a tapered end to ensure less damage to the catheter as well as the soft tissues. The needle has a clear hub called as flash chamber. So it basically has the needle, stilet, a clear hub. The needle has a clear hub known as flash chamber, which fills with blood when the tip of the needle enters the lumen. So as the blood, the tip of the needle enters the lumen, there will be a flash of blood in the chamber at the back. The cap on the needle should be removed before insertion to facilitate the movement of blood into the flash chamber. So when the tip of the needle enters the blood vessel, the catheter is advanced over the needle into the lumen of the blood vessel. So initially the catheter, the needle and the catheter both are inserted through the skin. Now this needle and the catheter, when they both inserted to the skin, the needle, it has a tapered end. This is to prevent damage to the needle as well as to prevent damage to any skin, right, during insertion. So the the stilet is covered. The needle, basically the catheter, the stilet is within the needle. It has a tapered end. I'm sorry, the stilet is within the catheter, and the catheter and the stilet both are advanced. And as the tip of the needle hits the stilet, needle, when I say needle, it refers to the stilet. So as the tip of the needle hits the vein, there will be a black backflow of blood into the chamber of the needle. Right, it has a transparent hub, so with the backflow, you know that the needle is in the vein, and then over the needle, the catheter is pushed into the vein, and the needle is taken out, and the catheter is closed. Whereas your central venous catheters, it is designed for cannulation of the larger veins like the subclavian vein, internal jugular vein, femoral vein. They are much longer than the peripheral catheters. They are typically 15 to 25 centimeters. So the central catheters, that was around 5 centimeters. The central catheters are 15 to 20 centimeters long. Right? They are also available in 2 to 3 separate infusion channels, which are advantages when. So it has a separate infusion channels to 1 to 3, and this is advantages when multiple medications are required to be given. So open-ended central venous catheter, the catheter is open at the distal tip, and the catheter requires clamping before entry into the system. The clamps are usually built into the catheter and requires periodic flushing. So these are the clamps, these blue things that you all see at the end. These here are the clamps, okay, so which are fitting over these colorful things. So the blue things are the clamps. So the catheter is open at the distal tip, and it requires clamping for entering into the system, because once the catheter enters the system, the blood will flow back, and if these are not capped, there will be backflow. Clamps are usually built into the catheter, so these are also clamps here. Two types of clamps. These are basically one-way valves. These are clamps. These are one-way valves, which also prevent black backflow like the clamps. And it requires periodic flushing. So blood cannot be allowed to remain here, otherwise it will clot. So this requires periodic flushing. Now the closed-ended catheters. A valve is present at the tip of the catheter or at the hub of the catheter. So valve is present at the tip of the catheter. Here it is ingrained into the catheter. Clamping is not required as the valve is closed except during infusion or aspiration. Now composition types of central venous catheters. Like I told you, it can be silicone or polyurethane. Silicone is basically for long standing catheters are made of silicone. That is when you're keeping them for weeks to months. And shorter use catheters are made of polyurethane. The coating is antimicrobial or antiseptic, apparent coating, and radio opaque to confirm tip placement. So to confirm tip placement, when you take an x-ray, these are radio opaque. So basically, how are they radio opaque? Because they are coated with barium or tungsten. Okay. Then antimicrobial or antiseptic coating. Type of therapy to be administered, long-term therapy, previous devices and complications, patient for preference. So the type of CVC that is inserted basically depends on length of therapy, short or long term therapy, previous devices, complications, patient preference. So whether we insert single lumen, double lumen, so length of therapy, so whether to insert a silicone or polyurethane, it depends on the stage of the patient. That can be estimated. Then the type of therapy being administered, whether any vasopressors are administered or if any, dialysis has to be done. So then an HD hemodialysis catheter will have, central catheter will have to be inserted. Then if it is for chemotherapy, then how many ports are required for chemotherapy. Then previously whether any devices, so then site of insertion changes, previously any devices were used, what were the complications with those devices, what are the patient preferences. So all these are the various things that determine the CVC that is inserted. Then non-tunneled catheters. So polyurethral, they are basically used for short term. So polyurethane is basically for short term use. Catheters are made up of polyurethane. They can be single or multiple lumen catheters. Flow varies depending on the size. So the flow in the catheter will vary depending on the size and the ID. They can be inserted percutaneously, like in the internal jugular vein, the subclavian vein, the femoral vein. So the flow varies depending on the size inserted of the catheter inserted. When inserted percutaneously, it can be inserted in the internal jugular vein, the subclavian vein, or the femoral vein. So advantages are with this polyurethane, it is easier placement, removal, and replacement. It is more economical. These are cheaper than the silicone ones. However, there is disadvantages are the highest risk of infection is seen with these catheters. The unused ports may be routinely flushed with heparin solution, and the unused ports has to be repeatedly flushed with heparin solution and clamped. These can get dislodged more easily, and it is temporary and requires frequent exchanges, right? So highest risk of infections is seen with this. Unused ports may be routinely flushed with heparin solution and clamped. They have to be flushed with heparin solution and clamped. These get dislodged more easily. So these catheters get dislodged more easily, and they are temporary. So they require frequent exchanges. So the insertion. Firstly, wait, I'll just complete with the catheters also. So basically this, so this antimicrobial impregnated catheters, so central venous catheters, I'm sorry, I forgot to cover this part. So the central venous catheters, They are available with two types of antimicrobial coating. So two antimicrobial coating. Okay, one uses combination of chlorhexidine and sulfur salicylazidine. So chlorhexidine plus sulfur sulfadiazine. So chlorhexidine plus silver sulfadiazine, and the other uses a combination of minocycline and rifampin. Okay, so combination. So chlorhexidine plus silver sulfadiazine, and the other uses a combination of minocycline and rifampin. Okay, so combination of minocycline plus rifampin. So the earlier catheters used chlorhexidine and silver sulfadiazine on the outer catheter surface, and only 2 to 9 studies evaluating these. So only few studies evaluating, about 2 to 9 studies evaluating these, showed that there was a reduction in the rate of septicemia. So superior results have been seen with this combination. So this combination has shown superior results. They have antimicrobial bonding on both the outer as well as the inner surfaces, and so they have antimicrobial activity for up to 4 weeks. Whereas with your chlorhexidine plus sulfadiazine, only 1 week of antimicrobial activity is seen with this type of catheter. So this, at this point, this seems like the catheter which is better, even though there are newer chlorhexidine and sulfadiazine catheters which are available with bonding on antimicrobial bonding on both surfaces, that is the inner and outer surfaces. Antimicrobial impregnated catheter should be considered if the rate of catheter related septicemia in the ICU is greater than the average rate. So then only antimicrobial coated catheters are seen. Now your heparin coated bonded catheters. So your heparin bonded catheters, the intravascular portion of the central venous catheter, so some part of the catheter is out, right? So the intravascular portion can serve as a nidus for thrombus formation, and this can lead to thrombotic occlusion of the involved blood vessel, right? As well as it can lead to septicemia. So basically how this happens is because the microorganism basically becomes trapped and proliferates in a fibrin meshwork of the thrombus. So that's how septicemia also occurs. So the part of the catheter which is inside the blood vessel, the microorganism, if there is a clot forming, can get clot caught within that fibrin slot of the clot and can lead to septicemia, right? The risk of catheter related thrombosis varies with the site of the venous cannulation. The incidence is, so the thrombus formation incidence is basically highest with the femoral vein. So with the femoral vein is the highest. The incidence is 20%, and with the subclavian vein, the incidence is 2%. Okay, so central venous and pulmonary artery catheters are now available with the heparin coating on the external surface to prevent thrombus formation. So the catheters are now available with the heparin coating on the external surface to prevent thrombus formation. There is indication that it causes a small decrease in thrombus formation, like about 2% decrease in even catheter-related infections. However, heparin coating is usually washed away by the flow of blood and can be completely lost in just a few hours after the catheter is placed. That is the disadvantage. More reports are there that heparin bonded catheters can cause heparin induced thrombocytopenia. So the disadvantages with this heparin coating is it gets washed away. And it leads to heparin induced thrombocytopenia, right? So the benefit-risk-benefit ratio is the benefit of this heparin catheter is small because it gets washed away. So the risk ratio is more because of that heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. Now these multi-lumen catheters, the central venous catheters, so the multi-lumen catheters are available with 1, 2 or 3 infusion channels. And that this I already showed you. So they are available with 1, 2 or 3 infusion channels. The multi-lumen catheters are the most popular because they allow multiple infusions through a single venipuncture. So this is going through only one vein, but they multiple in 3 infusions can go, right? The popular triple-lumen catheter has an outside diameter of 7 French. So the popular, this triple lumen catheter has an outside diameter. So the 7 French is the outside diameter, right? And houses 1 16 gauge and 2 smaller 18 gauges. So this yellow one is your 16 gauge. So it has 1 16 gauge and 2 smaller 18 gauge channels. Okay. The distal opening of each channel is separated from the other by at least 1 centimeter to prevent mixing of solution. So in the distal end over here, there are 3 openings. So they are separated from each other so as you can see, this is the distal, this is a cross section, but they are separate. So one will be here, one will be here, and one will be here. They are separated at different distances to prevent mixing of the infusate. Okay. But these catheters are a potential risk for infection. And it's not like infection rate is prevented by these multi-lumen catheters. Now insertion, so basically the Seldinger technique is used. So basically for insertion, informed consent, sterile technique, adequate preparation with sterilizing solution, setup of equipment, positioning and identifying landmarks, and adequate local analgesia should be used. Now the Seldinger technique is what is usually used. Okay. In this, the central venous catheter is placed by threading the catheter over. So the catheter in this method is threaded over a, you all have to remember that method, Seldinger. The catheter is threaded over a guide wire. Okay, it was introduced, it was called Seldinger after its founder in 1950s. A small bore needle, usually a 20 gauge, is used to probe for the target vessel. When the tip of the needle is in the target vessel, a long thin wire, so a small probe needle, so this is the probe needle, okay. It is used to go into the, so this syringe is attached and the probe needle is probed in the direction that we will come to each vein, how to, which direction to go, etc. It is probed. Once the needle is in the vein, there will be a backflow into the syringe. The needle will be disconnected. This guide wire will be passed through this 20 gauge needle. Then the needle will be withdrawn over the guide wire. The guide wire will be in the vein. Then the vein has to be dilated with this dilator. After the so this dilator will be passed over the guide wire. The vein will be dilated. The dilator will be removed, and after that the catheter is passed over the guide wire. The guide wire is removed through the, one of the ports of the catheter, and backflow is checked in each of the three ports. So the first catheter inserted in the large central vein is usually a large bore introducer catheter. Once in place, these catheters are fixed to the skin. So once this catheter is inserted, it is fixed to the skin with a suture. Okay, and backflow has to be checked in these ports.
This was like the basics of just a second. So this was the basics on about the catheter, the types of catheter, and the types of insertion of the central venous catheters, how they are threaded over the guide wire, and the silicone polyurethane catheters, silicone polyurethane catheters, then the antimicrobial catheters, heparin infused catheters. So these are all the various type of catheters that are being used, and the method used to insert this central line into, so there are different type, multi-lumen, single lumen catheters, multi-lumen catheters, peripheral catheters, non-tunnel, tunnel, and the method to insert is a Seldinger's technique, where after informed consent, sterile technique, adequate skin preparation, setup of equipment, positioning and identifying of landmarks, adequate local analgesia has to be used. Then after painting, sterile draping and dressing, etc. So Seldinger's technique is, this 20 gauge needle is used to find the vein. Once there is backflow in the needle, the syringe is removed, the guide wire is passed through the needle. And once the guide wire is in, the needle is removed over the guide wire. Then the vein will be dilated. So the dilator is passed over this guide wire. The vein is dilated. Then the guide wire is removed. The dilator is removed. And this catheter is passed over the dilator, over the guide wire. The guide wire will be removed through one of these ports. And as the guide wire is being removed, this catheter is pushed in. And then the catheter is sutured. So guys, that was to now the class, the initial part of central venous cannulation access. I will continue this class at 8 p.m. today. So do log in. See you all soon. There is a half an hour break. 8 p.m. I shall continue this class. Do use my code to avail your 10% discount. Thank you guys.